outdoors. We're glad to have him. Brother Nathan Shelton's going to lead us in worship tonight. And let me just tell you about that tonight before we get started. Sunday night, 7 o'clock, starting Sunday night, through Wednesday, and maybe right on until the Lord comes down. We're going to be in the Bible, we're going to be in these rooms. With Brother David and Brother Nathan are going to be here, and the ministry team from Reward Outdoors. Let's give God a hand clap of praise. Let's go ahead and give the Lord a hand clap of praise. And let's thank the Lord for Brother David and Nathan and the team coming tonight. Amen. Come on, guys.
Oh, Thank you. Sinner's prayer. He said, you must be born again. Now, you come here tonight probably to get something to eat and thought you were going to go into some kind of an auction where you're going to possibly win one of those nice guns. But there's another auction going on here tonight. There's another raffle that's happening that you don't see. And it's in a spiritual raffle. There's one that's calling out for your soul tonight. He said, just stay where you're at. Keep being the way you are. Don't listen to that guy there. Don't listen to the worship music. You're good. You're on the church road. You're baptized. But deep down in your heart, you know that voice speaking to you that's trying to auction and bid on your soul is not God. He said, stay with me. I'll give you fame, fortune. I'll give you money. You can run around. You can do things you want to do as long as you go to church on a Sunday morning. And that voice is the voice of Satan, the enemy of your soul, the one that's come to kill, steal, and destroy. But there's another voice calling tonight. He said, I'll give you joy unspeakable and full of glory. He says, I'll give you forgiveness. There's things in your past, whether it be abortion, addiction, divorce, all the things that men hold against you, God says, I'll cast it from the east into the west. Amen. You can have it tonight if you want. That's the two bids tonight. Which voice are you going to answer? You say, well, I'm not going to answer either one. You do answer. Not to answer is to answer. God is calling for your soul. This ain't a game. It's not religion. It's your soul that weighs in the balance. The Bible says, what would it profit a man to gain the whole world and lose his soul? Your soul is the most valuable thing you possess. You may have a lot of money in the bank. You may have a big house, a nice car, beautiful wife or husband. But the truth is, the most valuable thing you possess is your soul. Amen. Do you know that your soul is eternal? This is not the end of your life. This is just a spot. The Bible says this is a vapor. This little dash between birth and death is what we're living. It's just a small little dash. It's just a vapor and it's gone. God is saying that today is the day of salvation. You're not promised tomorrow. And we see what's happening in our country, around the world. Small revivals are spurting out, but there's one big one going on in Kentucky. We had the opportunity to go and visit. And there's many people that have something negative to say because they don't see what they want to see or they don't hear what they want to hear. But I'm telling you today, God has heard the prayers of his people, calling out for revival and asking for an awakening. For years, people have been leading and praying. God is answering prayer. Are you going to get in the fire? Are you going to get in the wave of glory that's passing through? Or are you just going to sit still and watch it go by? I'm talking to Christians now. God saved your soul if you're a child of God. He reached way down for me. I don't know how far he reached for you. He reached real way down for me. I made up my mind. I'm going to worship God if nobody else does. I'm going to serve him if nobody else does. Not because I'm something, but because of what he is. And that same person of Christ, the Holy Ghost, that reached down and drug me out of my land, touched me and saved me, the same spirit person that's moving here tonight. There's a spirit. There's two spirits in here. There's a spirit of oppression. I felt it. I felt it when I walked in the door. But that's nothing against you because that's normal. Anytime God is going to do something, there is a spirit of oppression. The enemy will rise up and try to snuff it down, try to stop it. And that's one reason I want to get you to worship tonight, because when we worship God, it pushes the enemy back. But the Word of God comes out of the shepherd and a two-edged sword and it's going forward. I don't stand up here as a polished preacher. Y'all probably figured that out by now. I'm not articulate. I didn't graduate my class most to be a preacher. Matter of fact, I graduated way down low in my class most to smoke weed and drink and party and have a big time. God called me to preach. God pulled me out. But before he did, I was on the church road. Maybe like you. My grandpa was a deacon. My daddy was a deacon. And I said, well, I'm going to say a prayer. I'm going to get baptized. I'm good. And I thought that religion was Jesus. I thought that going to a Greek building, I thought that listening to a sermon, paying my tithes, maybe somebody you think if you just keep the church and pay your tithes, you've done God a favor. God don't need your money. God wants your soul. I thought because I've done religious things, therefore I must be a Christian. And there's many people like that tonight. There's many people that think they're a child of God because they do religious things. You don't even compare to Nicodemus. Do you pray 2 hours a day every day? Do you fast 2 days a week? Do you know the Bible in and out? Nicodemus knew all of this, and yet Jesus said, that's not enough, Nicodemus. It's not enough. It's not about what you do. It's not about what you think you can do for God. It's about an encounter with God at the cross of Jesus Christ. When you come to the cross, God shows you who you really are.
That's right.
You ain't gonna like it. You don't feel like it's your best day now when you come to the cross of Christ. You feel burdened, overwhelmed by your sin and guilt. God lets you sense and feel what Christ turned for you on the cross. Long before you were born, Jesus Christ died on the cross for you. He saw you before the foundations of the world. And when Christ was on the cross, you were on his mind. He's never forgotten you. He's never forsaken you. He loves you with an everlasting love. And with loving kindness, he's drawing you tonight. When Christ was hanging on that cross, he could have come down. No man made him stay up there. He chose the cross. The Bible said, for the joy set before him, he endured the cross. Why? Why was it a joy for God to die on the cross? Because it was for you. For you. Do you realize how much you're loved? It was a joy, brother, for God to hang on the cross for you. Because he knew when his blood was being splattered all over the ground that your sins were being paid for and the power of the Most High was going to come and rescue you. Amen. So tonight, why did you come? You come for the wrong reason. Thank you. I appreciate that. But the truth is, amen. Most people probably came because it was a giving. Most people probably felt like, well, this is going to be a nice thing to give. And it is very nice. But this is all going to pass away. The world is going to come to an end sooner or later. What happened this night in your life that made a difference? So you can go out that door the same way you come in. And nobody's going to say much to you. The enemy will even help you with that. He'll tempt you to do that. But the reason there's such a pull on your life, and the reason you're struggling, the reason you feel this burden all before you come here tonight, is God is drawing you. Now, for some of you, you've been saying that God is trying to draw you back to your first love. You've drifted away. Why? Because the world is awful. It's tough. It's hard. And you don't see God answering your prayers. You say, well, I pray, and he didn't answer. He didn't answer the prayer I prayed. And so what happens? We get a root of bitterness. But what God is wanting us to do is die to ourselves, church. He's wanting to stop depending on what we think or what we want and just trust him in the middle of this dark hour. Because he did say you were the salt of the earth, the light of the world. And you're not being the salt and the light when you're complacent, apathetic, asleep. If you really want revival, for some of y'all it's going to be here Sunday night. If you really want revival, I'm going to make you a promise. You come prayed up to worship God. Not to hear me. Not to, for any reason other than to give God glory. If you come Sunday night to worship God, that's all they did in Asbury, Kentucky. They went in there for a regular chapel on a Wednesday. 20 to 30 folks stayed out. Police officer that kept stays in there and the security, I talked to him personally. He said it was an unremarkable sermon. It wasn't really a remarkable sermon. And the man did a good job and he left, but 20 or 30 people stayed. And you know what they done? They worship God. That's all they done. And God starts pouring his spirit out. Now people have been there from Brazil and Iran and all over the country. And you say, well, that's Asbury, Kentucky. Do you not realize that 1906 there was an outpouring in Dunn, North Carolina? Do you not realize that the Spirit of God will pour out all up and down the East Coast? We are standing in a historical place at a very pivotal moment in history. And church, you've got to wake up and realize that God's calling you. Come out and pray tonight. So what are you going to do with it? I don't want religion. I don't want to be churchy. I just want more of God. And there are people here tonight, maybe watching online, you're lost. And you don't want that junk either. You want something real. You don't want religion where you go to church on Sunday and you pass the deacon in the liquor store coming out Monday. You don't want that. Who wants? had a big time when I hung out with my lost friends. I don't hang around church folks because they're fun. Most of them are boring. I'm being honest. Y'all can pretend. So if I was going to be a member of a club, I'll just go back to the club. Amen. But what God done to me would give me something real. That's realer than anything I've ever had. Realer than a gold cross on the wall or a pulpit or stained glass windows and steeples. It was the Spirit of the living God that He gave me. And when He done that for me, I'm sorry, I'm making it too close. It changed me. Now, if you are a Christian tonight and there is no change in your life, then I challenge that you're not. You cannot meet the God of glory and be the same. You say, well, bless God. I've been a member of the Lutheran Church for 36 years. Well, you better get born again. Because God is not going to make excuses when you stand before Him in judgment. He's not going to listen to your excuses. All He's going to know is that you come by the blood of the Lamb of God. Period. When are you born again? I told you I was in the church row lost for 15 years. 15 years lost. My preacher was like a grandfather to me. I loved him. And when he preached, I didn't really listen a whole lot. And he passed away. And another preacher came. And he preached that hell was hot. And it's a real place. And I didn't like that. I didn't like the way he made me feel. And when he would preach that way, he would look at me. And I swear I thought he was looking dead at me. And I would give him the evil eye right back. And he would look. I'm on the back row. And he would stare at me. And I'd stare back. He weren't looking at me. You may think, hey, that guy's looking at me. I'm not looking at you, I promise. That's conviction. And I'd walk out the church to shake his hand. And he goes, I'm praying for you. And I said, I'm praying for you too. Squeeze it just as hard as I can. And one Sunday morning, he preached. I didn't listen to nothing he said. I didn't like it. And I fell under conviction. And I felt like I was naked, butt naked in a church. I felt like if you looked at me, you could see through me. And I felt the presence of God. And I squeezed that pew, and I said, I'm not going. But I didn't say it to the preacher. I said it to the Lord. And when I said that, you know what happened? It was like letting the wind out of my going. See, the Bible says that He's like the wind. You can't see Him, but you can see where He's going, where He's, you see Him moving. I can see Him moving tonight, but you can't see Him visibly. But He's an ever-present help in time of trouble. He's also a reprover of sin, righteousness, and judgment. He's moving tonight in your heart. He's moving through this congregation. Amen. And He was dealing with me. The same Holy Ghost that raised Jesus from the grave was in my church that morning trying to get me to come to the altar. The same Holy Ghost. I said no. How many times have you said that? How many times has God said, today is the day? But you said no. Because I don't want anybody to think I'm not saved. I don't want anybody to talk about it. Those are the things that did, because my grandpa's a deacon. My daddy's a deacon. I'm on the church road. God says, I don't care about any of that. See, when you come to the cross, you don't come proudly. The Bible says, God resists the proud. But give grace to the humble. God humbles you and you come to the cross like a little child, Jesus said. Come as a child. A child doesn't have pride. A child just believes. And that's how you come to Jesus tonight. Believe. I'm going to make this short because I don't want to hold you up. But I went back home after that Sunday morning and I started waking up in the middle of the night at 3:33 on the dot. When something would shake me, wake up! And it was demonic. I know this is a Pentecostal church. I grew up in a non-Pentecostal church. We didn't believe in that. We didn't talk about it. This was a demon. And it would wake me up at 3:33, and I didn't know what it was. I just knew it was a dark presence, a very evil, hopeless presence would come across me. And it would say, not in my ear, but in my heart, my mind would speak in my mind, it would say, you have gone too far. You blaspheme the Holy Spirit because you didn't receive that day what God was dealing with you. You're mine. The first week, I ignored it. I'd wake up at 3:33 and I'd ignore it. I'm pretty tough. But the second week, I started breaking down. And my wife started coming in and said, we just bought a brand new, beautiful, big house for swimming pool. All I had it going on. And she would come in the kitchen at 3:33, and I'm crying at the counter, bawling. And she's like, what in the world is going on with you? What's wrong? And I didn't want to tell her. I'd say, I believe I'm going too far, and I can't be saved. And she's like, well, you're already saved. You're already saved. This started happening at 3:33 every morning. Wake up! I become very depressed. Now, if anybody's ever struggled with depression in here, it's a deep, dark hole. You don't just get there overnight. Things get you to a point, and then when you, it's hard, you don't come out overnight. And I was so depressed, I was having a panic attack. Meanwhile, the demon was still taunting me, you're mine. And every wicked, foul, wicked thought that could run in my mind, he was running 24/7. At the same time, all my sins were being real before my eyes, I believe, by the Spirit of God. At the same time, because I was remembering stuff I forgot about. And I was so tortured in my mind, I couldn't function. I couldn't eat. I couldn't sleep. I couldn't work. I cried all the time. I had to sell the house that we just moved into and move back into a mobile home because I couldn't pay for it. I couldn't work. I was having a breakdown. My dad says, I want you to get some help and go see a therapist. So I went to see this man. He says, I told him the long version of what I'm telling y'all tonight for time. He said, well, I can help you. You've got obsessive compulsive disorder. I said, well, thank God. Because I can fix that, right? He said, yes, what's your greatest fear? I said, then I'm going to die and go to hell. He says, your obsession is you sin, and your compulsion is forgiveness. You need forgiveness, right? I said, yeah. He goes, there you go. He says, I can help you. He says, my dad was a preacher. He said, what are you really afraid of? I said, that I'm going to die and go to hell. He says, no man ever knows if they're going to go to heaven until they stand before God. Now, when he said that, I rolled off the couch crying. I said, you're lost! You're as lost as I am! You still got a chance! Repent now! Be born again! You're lost! And he starts going, that's a pain, Paxel. Hands me the prescriptions. He says, come back next Tuesday. I cried all the way home. The only hope I had was in a man that was going to help heal my mind. But I knew it was spiritual. I don't know what you're going through tonight. You may be going through a loss of a loved one. You may be dealing with a broken marriage, a messed up family, sickness, disease. And it may be a guilt from, again, like abortion. That's something the devil really uses. Divorce, all kind of things. But the truth is, God will heal you tonight. He will forgive you and set you free. And when I come back to my mobile home, a preacher comes by. And he says, I heard you've been going through a rough time. I said, yeah. And I told him the long version. He says, you need to praise God. I said, praise God? You're crazy. He goes, you praise God. If God was done with you, you wouldn't care. If you have blasphemed the Spirit of God, you wouldn't care. You'd be out there in the world living like hell, wouldn't care. That's the only way to put it. That's what you'd be doing. Because the Spirit of God is the only restrainer and conviction on your life. Without the Holy Ghost, you don't care about nobody or nothing. He said, I didn't believe it, but it is the truth. And so I said, I'm going to do whatever I got to do. He says, you praise God. He leaves. I looked at Paxil, Lorazepam, I think it's with him, Lorazepam, and all this stuff. And I said, I'm going to praise God. Now listen, I'm having panic attacks. I'm crazy. I'm losing my mind. I want to be numb. I want to do something to numb it. But God, I felt a small, still voice. Trust me, not my medication. I'm not saying there's nothing wrong with medication. I'm on one. Yeah, nothing wrong with medication. But it was spiritual. God was dealing with me with something spiritual. People medicate conviction sometimes. You do it with alcohol, drugs, sometimes prescription. You medicate conviction. You say, I don't feel good about my life. I don't like things. Well, are you born again? Because if you're not born again, you're not going to have joy. You're not going to have peace. You're going to have emptiness all the time. A dark place. You just don't have peace when you're by yourself. You don't have peace when you're with all your friends. You still don't have peace. That's because you were created to be inhabited by the Spirit of God. God wants to dwell in you. So I just started praising God. The first day of praising God, I started feeling better. I weren't having as many bad thoughts and like a reel of just wickedness. It started easy because I was just praising God. The second day of praising God, I was halfway out of that deep hole of depression. I weren't having panic attacks. I could feel weight lifting off of me. The demon had simply felt like he had just moved away. Maybe it was on the outer perimeter, but it weren't in my face. It got to the point where I got excited. I'm riding through the woods with my four-wheeler. I'm praising God. I'm walking around and praising God. The third day of giving God praise and glory, I was healed in my mind completely. Yes. Amen. Yes. The power and praise. But I was still lost. I was still lost. He causes it to rain from the just and the unjust. Now, this was August. This lasted, not trying to be all biblical, but it was about 40 days of hell while I went there. In August, it ended. From August to January, I went to every revival I could find, every church service I could find. You know what I wanted? I bet some of y'all know what I was looking for. Just draw me one more time, Lord. Like you did that Sunday morning. Just one more time. Somebody out there that said, God, if you just deal with me one more time, well, guess what? He is. One more time. One more time, Lord. And every church play, nothing. People walking by me, I feel like I was dead. I'm dead. God healed my mind. He touched me. Maybe he don't want me to be crazy because my parents would have to take care of me. Oh, I'm thinking all kinds of stuff, but maybe just trying to settle me down so I won't be so crazy. Because I'm about to lose it. Dead. That same preacher come by my house January 18, 2003. He said, he was glowing. Have y'all ever seen somebody so full of the Spirit of God they're glowing? Amen. And you say, man, I wish I am what he's got or she's got. That's what he looked like. And I said, why are you so happy and joyful? He said, man, I've been down in Florida at a minister's conference, and all week long preachers have been coming off the floor preaching, and we've been worshiping God all day. Praise God, let's go play golf. How does that go together? He said, let's just go play golf. So I grabbed my golf clubs. I didn't want to go. I wasn't doing anything else. And all the way there, I started telling them, I want what you've got. I want what you've got. We got to the clubhouse. It was a warm January day, a lot like today, warm. And it was full of what we call snowbirds from up north. They had flocked down to the golf course to play golf. I tell this up north, too. I told them in Maryland, doesn't it? All the numbers fly down and cover the golf course. It was packed. And he had a tee time. So we got out in the tee box, and there's all these snowbirds all the way around us. And he looks at me and he says, you can get it if you want it. I said, I want it. I want what you got. He said, let us pray. I said, oh my goodness. He started praying. He's like a holiness. Calling down the fire. And the more he prayed, I kept doing this in my club. And I kept walking over. And when he was done praying, I was all the way back at the golf cart. He told me to keep off by himself. And he looked at me and he says, you get it right today, or you won't get it right. Hell flew in me. I wanted to knock him out. You don't know what I've been through. You don't know how bad it's been on me. How dare you speak to me that way? But you know who was talking to me? The Spirit of God.
Amen.
Spoke through that man and said, you'll get it right today or you won't get it right. Amen. There was authority when he said it. You weren't there. It knocked me back. It was not a man that said that to me. And when I said hell flew in me, that's exactly what was flying in me. Resist. Don't let that happen. Don't humble yourself. We got back in the golf cart. I don't remember hitting the ball. I don't remember nothing. We got to tee box number 15 at Lamelette's Golf Course in Whiteland, North Carolina. And I'm sure I talked about Jesus. I'm sure I asked him a thousand questions. But all of a sudden, out of nowhere, with snowboards in front of us, snowboards behind us, us having to wait to get people out of the way to hit the ball, I started feeling something. I said, hold on. There's a presence. He had had that presence the whole time. God had been holding that presence from me. It is a precious gift tonight. If the Holy Spirit is dealing with you, it is a precious gift.
That's right.
He is not obligated to keep calling you. You'll get it right today, or you might not get it right. And as we're on that tee box, and I felt that presence, I said, I feel God. This is what I was looking for in all these revivals, sir. I feel God. I want to get saved right now. I feel Him drawing me. What I do? He said, just call on Jesus. I said, I know, but what I do? He said, David, just call on Jesus. And right there on tee box number 50, I put my hands together and I looked up and I said, Jesus. And when I did, I fell on my face, and a love and a power hit me. A love that I can't even put into comprehension. I can't explain to you how much God loves you. And I fell down, and I was praising God, and stuff was coming out of my face. I'm on my hands and knees. The preacher falls out in the grass, and he's praising God. People were skipping the hole because they thought we were crazy. They were just driving all around us leaving. And we stayed there. Worshiping God. As great as my sin was, much more greater is His grace. He took all that burden off me, all that weight, every bit of it. And we're worshiping God, and we get back in the golf cart, we start down the hill toward the clubhouse, but golf is over. We just worship Him now. And I started thinking about Jesus when He was on the cross, and I believe this is when He called me to preach that. Not at the time, but years later, I started thinking about Christ on the cross. And out of the blue, I started seeing in my mind a picture of Christ hanging on the cross, like you've seen probably in pictures. And when He was hanging there, He turned and He said, David. It was personal to Him. It was personal when God died. It was for you. He called your name out. He called your name out. It was personal. And I fell out of the golf cart. I was for sliding on my back in the grass. And the preacher jumps out and he starts running around preaching. He's all two pieces. He's preaching and I'm just crying and start all over again. We get home. I knock on that mobile home door. And Beverly looks at me, my wife. She says, something's happened to you. I left that place without God. I left that place a broke man, destitute, damn for hell, with no hope. And I walked back up there full of the Holy Ghost.
Yes.
And she said, something's happened to you. You can get it if you want.
That's right.
He's no respecter of persons. You may say, well, what about whatever happened to the demon? I actually had a preacher tell me one time, you don't need to tell it for your testimony. You'll be late working on it. Give up. It happened. You know what happened to him? The thought come one day. What if he comes back? And the minute that thought entered my mind, the Holy Spirit said, he's not coming back. Greater is He that's in you than he that's in this world. You may feel like the devil's in control. And he very well may be because of the way you're living your life. He does not have authority over a child of God. You do not bow to the enemy. He can lie, cheat, and steal, but you're a child of the Most High God, full of the Holy Ghost, the most powerful force in the universe. Do not forget who you are. But if you don't know Him today, the Bible says you can't serve two masters. Who's your father? Have you been born again? I'm going to ask you to bow your heads right where you're at. Now, there's decision cards on your table and a pen. I want to talk to the Christian right here. If something was said in this message and you know you have not been living the way you promised God you would and you know God has called you out today, I want you to write on that paper your name and your rededication. If you're lost, there's a place on there for salvation. There's also a place on the back to write a prayer request. And on the way out the door, there's a little black box. I want you to put these cards in that black box. Your prayer request, your decision for Christ, whether it was to rededicate your life, our first time salvation. And that's what I need you to do, so we know we reached every one of you. But I'm going to do something public tonight, because it was very public when Christ hung on the cross for you. He hung there naked. It wasn't a beautiful sight. It wasn't a beautiful robe wrapped around him. He was naked, shamed and humiliated by man for you. He says, I'm not ashamed of you. I saw you smoking weed. I saw you when you were having that affair. I saw you from the foundations of the world. Yet I love you anyway. I love you. I love you. I love you. The devil says, you can't be loved. God says, I proved my love by the cross. I died for you and rose again the third day. If God has been dealing with your heart and you are hearing this group and you know that you're not right and God is calling you, I want you to stand up right now and come to this altar now. I'm going to ask everybody here to stand right now. Will you please stand with me? You come to this altar tonight and make a public profession to Christ. Why do I ask you to do that? Because he said, if you're ashamed of me, I'll be ashamed of you when you come before my Father and Holy Angel. There is somebody or some people in here that need to come. You come down here to this altar and you stand and we're going to pray with you. You make a decision for Christ tonight. You say, I'll make my decision tonight. You're not promised tomorrow. You're not promised another day. It's your soul that God is interested in. Don't matter what nobody thinks. Don't matter what people say. This is for you. You come tonight. You come while Christ is calling you and receiving tonight. Would you come? Come on.
Just as I am. Start praying. Brother
Nathan, Brother David, and the team is going to be here. And I believe that God wants to do something very, very, very special. Can you say amen?
Amen.
Amen. Amen. It doesn't matter who it is, what color they are, how they talk, or how they look. God wants to test them. Andy Cole, are you here? Andy Cole, you're going to have to give us a few instructions about the guns. And Danny Coates,
can we bring them up here?
Yeah, bring them up here, Danny.